Caulfield from Cambridge University. He will present a lecture on turbulence in stratified fluids.
Thank you very much for this invitation. And thank you also for this opportunity to not be in the UK at the moment. So this is my second visit to Les Ouches, and Berenger was here at the previous time. I was here in January, and this is going to be quite related to the talk I gave there, with some a little bit more pedagogical background. I'm particularly interested in problems in turbulence where the density differences matter. We had this morning, Laurent said that density was one, and then we had Jacques say that density was almost one. And essentially, even though density is almost one and doesn't vary very much at all, the dynamical effects can be enormously significant, which is what I want to talk about. Of course, there has to be some shout-outs to funding agencies. We've just finished a five-year project on the mathematical underpinning of stratified turbulence, supported by EPSRC in Cambridge and in Bristol. There was a large number of people involved in this project. Paul Linden was the PI, and there were four other faculty involved in it. And I'm going to be talking about some of those things today, as well as some component, essentially pedagogical. I understand that there's a very broad community here of people interested in turbulence, and they haven't necessarily, though there are undoubtedly experts in the audience, there are also people who perhaps aren't obsessed with understanding the significance of density differences on turbulence. And so I'll try and have a bit of a pedagogical background. But also, most importantly, I want to draw analogies. And so an alternative title for this whole talk would be to show you the way that stratified turbulence is like Brexit. It's kind of obsessing me at the moment. At the back during the talks, I was checking out what was actually happening. And the most important thing for you to understand about both stratified turbulence and Brexit is nobody understands what is happening. Effectively, that is the most important thing for you to appreciate. The stratified turbulence problem is wide open. There are order one disagreements in the community about what's happening, and we really don't understand what is going on. So it's really an important area, I think, for people to work on. And part of the problem is to do with definitions. The Prime Minister of the UK at the moment, perhaps until the end of the week, used the wonderful mantra that Brexit means Brexit, but what does that mean? And a very similar concept can be held into stratified turbulence means stratified turbulence, but the stratified turbulence that Jacques was talking about is different from the stratified turbulence that I might be talking about, is different from the stratified turbulence that oceanographers. There's a real issue in this area of definition of what is actually being talked about, which has led to an awful lot of muddied conversations in the literature and in the conferences, which makes it extremely difficult for new people to come into this area. Now, with my particular Irish nationality involved, there's also the critical point is what happens near the boundaries is most important, which certainly interacts with Laurent's talk. It's very nice to do theory in homogeneous isotropic turbulence and say, oh, we don't worry about the boundaries. But if you're wondering about modeling mixing in the ocean or stratified turbulence in the ocean or stratified turbulence in the atmosphere, the boundaries play an order one role. You can never ignore the presence of the boundaries, just as you can never ignore Ireland. And so it's a very important topic to appreciate about this. And also, and this is for the people who do the numerical problems, being free, a freely evolving stratified flow, is very different from a flow that is forced. And this is it's very curious about understanding the properties of turbulence. You think that you, and this I really think is emerging, the idea you know, the Kolmogorov type idea that you can be in this inertial you're in this inertial range, and if you're far enough separated from your forcing and far enough separated from your viscosity, there's no imprint on that piece of information. For many situations, it appears in stratified flows, whether the flow is freely evolving or whether you have some internal forcing is a key component. And I hope to be able to explain to you why that is so critical, because one of the fundamental problems about stratified turbulence is how do you manage to keep a flow turbulent when you have a stabilizing force like the buoyancy force. So that's a part. And also, history really matters. I think the idea about whether free decisions were being taken or whether decisions were forced by some external agents on Facebook is and also whether you living in Scotland can know that Scotland voted to stay in the European Union and is being forced to leave by the English Parliament. So anyway, and history really matters, which has the point in Ireland and in Scotland and in Wales, but also has an importance in the evolution of the flow. And once again, classical concepts we have about turbulence is that there can be this kind of stochastic, memoryless behavior of a flow. But in stratified flows, the history can really matter because the very process of having turbulence modifies the structure of the flow to an order one aspect. So if you have turbulence in a flow that has density stratification, the turbulence will tend to mix the fluid. If you tend to mix the fluid, you will then have regions of relatively weak gradient and regions of relatively strong gradient. And that irreversible modification of your base flow will mean that if you have been turbulent for a long time, the properties of your turbulence may be different from early in the flow evolution. And this is added complication for the stratified turbulence problem. Now, why are we interested in stratified turbulence? Well, of course, we're interested because the oceans and the atmosphere are stratified. There's density variations in them, and there is a huge amount of energy transported in the atmosphere and the ocean. And we see these beautiful simulations. So Jacques showed the simulation from NASA, and he also showed another simulation. Now that NASA simulation, I think, is of the order of 1/8 of a degree resolution. So you saw all that beautiful flow dynamics. Now to leading order, it's an easy way to remember, a degree of latitude is just over 100 kilometers, 111 kilometers at the equator. So a 1/8 degree resolution simulation has a grid box that's 12 kilometers across. Turbulence in the ocean is taking place on a scale of that order. It is enormously widely separated. You see those eddies, but to keep those codes working, and the beautiful Baylor Fox Kemper has this beautiful analogy that he has, that the way to understand what those fluids that you're seeing in those numerical simulations, they're not really water, they're really peanut butter. They are immensely viscous fluids that are being simulated. So to keep the flow stable, they have an enormously high viscosity in them. And so there is a parameterization, there is a modeling of the turbulence involved. So this is another one of these. This is ocean surface currents from altimetry in real time, which is one of these things that involves this sort of data simulation. You see the Gulf Stream, you see the Agulhas Current, you see the Kuroshio, you see that the point about the rotation, knowing about the key parameter of knowing about the latitude, you see these currents that know precisely that they're at the equator. There's all this dynamics that you have in the ocean, but you have to remember that the turbulence that is involved in this that is driving the vertical and poleward transport of heat in this system is taking place on a scale that is several, you know, in five or six orders of magnitude smaller than the resolution at which we are presently able to simulate this system. So it's enormously important to parameterize these systems. And there is a huge amount of energy. The amount, this is a plot of the poleward heat transport averaged over averaged over longitudes rather, and it's of the order of petawatts. There's a huge amount of heat being transported in the ocean, and understanding how that heat is transported is key to us understanding what's happening as we're increasing the carbon dioxide and methane content of the atmosphere. So, why do we worry? Well, here's a amazing plot from a very, very important paper, Waterhouse et al. In Journal of Physical Oceanography, where they collated a lot of the measurements of the dissipation rate. This is a plot of the dissipation rate. And this is the height above the bottom of the ocean. And if you're sitting at the back, the scale here is 2 kilometers. This is 2 kilometers above the base of the ocean is the data. And the lines are colored in depending on the properties of the boundary, the bottom boundary of the ocean. Whether it is smooth, which was defined in a certain, effectively about how large the topography is relative to some other scale. Then whether it is rough, which effectively means that it is the regions over which there's a lot of topography is relatively widely extended. And then ridges, of course you do have ridges, you know, there's a well-known ridge in the mid-Atlantic, for example, which is a very relatively narrow region of high topography. And the thing to draw from this picture, this data, is that enormously far above the base of the ocean, a kilometer above the bottom, where the rough, where there is a signal of how the roughness is changing, the basic properties between it being smooth and it being a ridge, you can have orders of magnitude difference in your dissipation rates. So there is a non-local, which is of course the internal wave field, there is a non-local way in which information is carried around in the turbulence in a stratified fluid to say it knows about the boundary. It can know about the fact that the properties of the boundary roughness is changing fully a kilometer above those mountain ranges. It's quite an astounding exercise. Now, so I say the mixing's happening on a centimeter scale. The models are running at best at 10 kilometer, at 1 to 10 kilometer scale. You have orders of magnitude difference. How are we going to model the meridional overturning circulation, the transport of heat? Because, of course, it's hotter near the equator than the poles. So how are we going to understand how we transport heat around? And that is, of course, enormously important because there is a rapid change in the properties of the ocean at the moment. These are two news stories from The Guardian that weren't to do with Brexit. And you see that the data is that the 2018 was the hottest year in the Earth's oceans. And this is a plot from 1955 to 2015 showing effectively a monotonic increase in the heat content of the ocean. And this is a real issue, right? Because if you heat up the oceans, they expand, kind of elementary. So their volume increases, so sea level rises, so move from the Netherlands. The ice loss on land is also happening. If it's floating, it doesn't matter, but if it's on a melt-off land, it does matter. And as you heat up the ocean, we now understand extreme events happen much more frequently. It buggers up the fishing possibility. And if you change the extreme events, the water supply, the monsoon, if the monsoon happens less frequently, that affects the food supply of 2 billion people. If you have much more extreme events, more hurricanes hitting the eastern seaboard of the United States, it will affect literally tens of millions of people. Billions of people will be affected by strongly modifying the properties of the transport in the oceans, and fundamentally the closing the model to understand how heat is transported around in the oceans is an exercise in modeling stratified turbulence. That is the fundamental question you need to be able to address to close this circulation between having heated hotter nearer the equator, colder near the poles. Because if there wasn't stratified turbulence, you would just have a very hot region at the top, and the lower body of the ocean would be cold, and it would just be stagnant. Yet we don't have that situation. So understanding why turbulent mixing can manage to give you a stratification in the interior of the ocean is fundamentally a stratified turbulence problem. So I'll just briefly show you why, obviously, the turbulence is an unbelievably difficult problem, hardest problem. You know, you go and ask God, he'll say, I can do quantum mechanics, I can't do turbulence, blah, blah, blah. But then the graduate course of that is the stratified turbulence, as I will now try and explain to you. So this morning, we didn't see this equation because we said density was 1. We ignored the body force. But we ignored this body force that is inevitably in the system by just saying, well, we can write that as, we can identify a hydrostatic component of that, which is associated with a hydrostatic pressure gradient. We absorb, if the density is constant, we can absorb that into the pressure field. If the density is constant, we can divide across. We get this equation, which was the one Laurent wrote up, by saying that rho is equal to 0. Rho is equal to 1. If rho is equal to 0, my life would be different. But when the density is constant, we have this very, very simple situation. But the ocean and the atmosphere are stratified. So we want to consider situations where this density field can be a function of space and time. Now, we can still extract a hydrostatic component. If you dive in a swimming pool to go and get a brick off the bottom of the swimming pool, you will still feel the pressure increasing. And as I came up in the shuttle coming up this mountain, I could feel the pressure was changing. My ears popped. But if you dive in the sea where there is a salt stratification or a thermal stratification, you will still also identify this change in the hydrostatic pressure associated with the body of fluid above you. So you can generalize the standard approach of saying the hydrostatic pressure gradient is constant if the density is constant, but you can still identify a hydrostatic pressure gradient if you have a density field that is a function of Z alone, just the depth alone. So this pressure gradient is no longer, if rho H is a function of Z, this pressure gradient is no longer constant, but it's still, I can still write this component in terms of a pressure gradient, a hydrostatic pressure gradient. So in general, I can write my density as this hydrostatic density field, which is a function purely of Z, and some perturbation away from that, which is a function of space and time. And then I can write my pressure, and as Laurent was saying, this pressure isn't the pressure of thermodynamics 101, it's a Lagrange multiplier that is imposing the fact that I have an incompressible fluid. But I can still decompose that into a hydrostatic component and a fluctuation away from that. And then I get this system of equations, which has this extra cheeky little term here to do with the density differences away from this hydrostatic component. And this is capturing the key body force, the buoyancy force, which is if I lift a dense parcel up, it will want to fall back. Okay, so we can have this term in our particular, we have this extra term in our Navier-Stokes equations, which plays a very important dynamical role. And why does it play a very important dynamical role? Well, there's at least two ways I think that it's key in its behavior. The first is if I imagine just dividing across this equation by rho, but allowing rho to be variable, well, then when I take the curl of this equation, I inevitably get another term. If I allow the density to generally vary in space and time, the vorticity equation has the terms that you're perhaps used to, the local variation, the advection of vorticity, the vortex stretching term, the viscous diffusion of the vorticity, but I get this extra term here, which allows me to have vorticity can be generated or destroyed in a stratified fluid if the pressure isosurfaces and the density isosurfaces are not parallel, if they're tilted relative to each other. And that is the most intuitive thing in the world, if you actually think about what would happen if I had light fluid here and dense fluid there. Because that, you would automatically assume what will happen will be that we'll want to tilt that like that. It will inevitably induce vorticity. That's what's called the baroclinic torque. Now, this baroclinic torque has a particularly simple form, which is the one I've basically drawn there, under what's called the Boussinesq approximation. And the Boussinesq approximation is a very important simplifying agent to what we want to do. And this, in over appropriate scales, is very reasonable approximation to do when you're thinking about the ocean and, to a lesser extent, when you're thinking about the atmosphere. So, salt water in the ocean is of the order of is about 3% more dense than fresh water. And also, if you change temperatures by about 10 degrees in air, you change the density by a few percent as well. And so why that is important is that that then tells you a nice approximation to make to this equation. Because it's a nice approximation to say, well, the density variation here probably doesn't matter much when I'm multiplying the pressure, but the density variation here when I multiply it by gravity may well make, I've got to keep that because that's the new physical force I have. It's the new buoyancy force. And so that is a key component that makes life a lot easier, and it's mathematically equivalent to the statement that we're on a planet that has enormously large gravity, but we have tiny density variations relative to this hydrostatic component, such that the product of those two, the buoyancy, remains finite. Okay? Now, if we furthermore say, rather once again divorcing ourselves from proper thermodynamics, we say, well, if we have relatively small density variations, if we think about how they might vary because of varying with temperature, if we do a Taylor series expansion, the leading order component is inevitably is going to be linear. We're going to have a coefficient of expansion, and we suppose that the density then just varies linearly with temperature. This has an interesting conclusion. It then means that if we say that we rather than having it to require the density to be thermodynamic and related to volumes and all the rest of it, we just say we have this property that it varies linearly with temperature, then the equation that the density field satisfies is actually this advection diffusion equation, where kappa is the diffusivity of whatever's causing the variation of the density, like the temperature. Now, this should perhaps stress you out if you haven't seen this before, because this appears to conflict with the conservation of mass, but it doesn't. Of course, what you're doing is you're capturing all the compressibility effects that are associated with you heat the fluid up, it expands. You capture it in this particular term here, and you can still formally have a fluid that is del dot u equals zero, and rho goes like this, and you have the equation, this equation here, for the velocity field. Okay, so why is this so nice? So now we have this system of equations. We have this equation for the evolution of the velocity field, the stratified Navier-Stokes equation, where we have this term here, which is the density fluctuation in the z direction, which allows us to capture buoyancy force-type terms. If we think about the vorticity, and we work through the appropriate form, it is precisely now the picture I've shown there. To leading order, the hydrostatic pressure variation is always going to have horizontal isosurfaces, isobars. And so this fact of this baroclinic generation of vorticity is entirely associated with situations where the density gradient varies in the horizontal, which is captured by this term, this baroclinic term. And if I now manipulate the previous equation I had for the density field, this advection diffusion equation, and I just multiply it by z, and why am I multiplying it by z? Well, if I multiply it by z, this will ultimately allow me to work out potential energy density. If I multiply it by z, well, I can take the z in turn inside the ddt term. That's trivial because it's just it's a partial derivative with respect to time. I can take it inside the Laplacian because, of course, even though it has two z derivatives, this is only one z, so that term disappears. But if I take it in turn inside this advection term, I'm going to then have another term where, by the product rule, I take the gradient of z, which gives me 1, by the density when I'm with the vertical velocity direction. So I have to add that in on the other side just by the product rule. But now if I step back, this then tells me something very, very interesting about the energetics of what will happen. So Laurent was saying, you look at this equation, you take its dot product with u, you can work out a kinetic energy equation, you get a perturbation kinetic energy. This term can be written in terms of a divergence of a flux. This term can be written as a divergence of a flux. This term has the sign definite dissipation term and then also a divergence. But I have a new term that survives, which would have a g prime by w, which would be a rho prime by w, which would have a minus before it. And so if on average I'm lifting dense parcels up, so if rho primed is positive and w is positive, I have an extra sink of my kinetic energy. I will be losing kinetic energy through this term, the buoyancy flux. But if I look at this equation and I multiply it by g and divide by reference density, because I'm in a Boussinesque sort of situation, I will have, that will be the local change in the potential energy. Once again, by incompressibility, this will be a divergence of a flux. I'll be able to work out a dissipation of this particular term, but it's got some diffusion-like properties. But I will have g over rho by multiplied by rho by w. And if I average it over a domain, in a horizontal plane, it's perfectly reasonable to suppose that the horizontal average of w will go to zero. And so therefore, the hydrostatic component of that rho that is a function purely of z, that will average out. And all I'll have will be precisely the opposite term of this. So the potential energy increases by precisely the same quantity as the kinetic energy decreases through this kind of exchange, the buoyancy flux between the two equations. And so remember what Laurent was talking about. He was talking about, we have this beautiful thing that goes on, and we have this, we inject forcing, and then we get a dissipation, and it's all very incredibly complicated, and we have this these different ranges, and it's all horrendously difficult. Well, it's even more difficult in a stratified problem because you have an extra sink on your kinetic energy. You have this extra, which I like to refer to as, it's like a tax. Because if you have turbulence in a stratified flow, you not only can lose kinetic energy to the internal energy reservoir through dissipation, you can also lose kinetic energy to the potential energy reservoir through this buoyancy flux. And so the fundamental question really at the heart of understanding stratified turbulence is, how do I model that term? So how do I parameterize this vertical diffusivity of heat? And it's all held in this particular picture here, which in pretty much every talk I give, I show. Suppose we have a patch of turbulence, and this blue line represents a background stratification. What is going to happen as that turbulence goes along? Is it going to do absolutely nothing to the stratification at all, and you just remain on the dashed line? Is it going to completely mix that stratification up? And if it mixes the stratification up fully and you get this well-mixed region in the middle, you'll see that the net effect of that has been to lift dense fluid up. It's increased the background potential energy of this system. Or is it going to be something in a compromise in between the green line? But that's the fundamental question that you need to address, which really, in a beautiful paper, very influential paper by Tom Osborne, is really all about this particular parameter, this flux coefficient gamma, which is the ratio between this buoyancy flux, the tax of having stratified turbulence in a stratified fluid, compared to the dissipation rate. Now, if you are completely statistically steady, if you look at, you will end up in your kinetic energy equation, which I'll kind of, the kinetic energy density equation here, you'll have a balance between your forcing, this buoyancy flux, and the dissipation. And so, if you're perfectly steady state, it seems reasonable that the buoyancy flux will scale with the dissipation, i.e. this quantity gamma will take some value, and it's typically assumed to be about 20%, you know, it's value-added tax, and it's a sales tax, a European-level sales tax, and it's that seems to be, that's what is basically used. That Waterhouse data I showed you, some of that Waterhouse data has used the value 20%. Now that's the kind of operational argument. And why is it the operational argument? Is because really what you want to do, as I said, you're modeling the ocean like it's peanut butter, you really want to have an eddy diffusivity, which can be thought mathematically as the way to turn a second order correlation between W and rho into something that's known in terms of the mean profiles d rho dz. And for an oceanographer, that's definitely the sort of thing that they have, because they can measure this. You can measure your density gradient easily. It's very, very difficult to measure your second order, your correlations between W and rho. Now, if I multiply this above and below by G over a reference density, I get the buoyancy flux on the top, and I get the buoyancy frequency, which Jacques already mentioned. Suppose I have a linear stratification. I lift a dense parcel up. It feels a restoring force because it's now dense. It will go down. And the frequency at which it oscillates is this buoyancy frequency. Now, if I just multiply, now this expression is just formal. Now if I multiply across above and below by nu, I will get diffusivity by a diffusivity and a parameter, this coefficient. And so this is a non-dimensional quantity here, which is called the buoyancy Reynolds number. And it's a combination, effectively, of a time scale associated with the turbulence and a time scale associated with the stratification. And so the fundamental question is it appropriate to say that gamma is a constant independent of other parameters, or does it depend on other parameters within our system? And that's the operational behavior is to suppose it doesn't, that it's just 0.2. There's then, and this is, as I say, it's an order one argument in the literature about what is actually the dependence of gamma on various parameters. So, and there are at least two levels of challenge associated with that. Because in a completely perfect world, i.e. in a numerical simulation or in a lab, how would you describe stratified turbulence? What is the right way to describe stratified? If I know everything about my flow, can I understand something about gamma? And can I understand something about stratified turbulence? And I want to understand gamma because this is what I want to work out. I want to work out kappa T. And then the second level of challenge is, well, I don't have perfect knowledge, so what is a useful way, if with what I can measure in the ocean or in the laboratory, to actually understand the flow? And there are central fundamental questions associated with that, which I show schematically here by ripping off the MATLAB logo. Which is, in general, gamma, this quantity I want to know, may depend on a Richardson number, which I'll come to in a minute, but is the ratio of the buoyancy frequency to the shear if I have a sheared flow. It may depend on the buoyancy Reynolds number. These are non-dimensional parameters. It's perfectly reasonable to make that statement. And so it's really difficult. It's not clear what gamma, in general, from sort of the Buckingham Pi argument, can depend on non-dimensional parameters. And there's a whole zoo of non-dimensional parameters I might have in such a flow, because I've got a range of length scales and I've got a range of time scales in my system, because I could have a shear, which introduces a time scale. How does that compare to the buoyancy frequency? I have the time scale of the turbulence, that epsilon over nu. How does that compare to the time scale of the decay rate of the turbulence, I suppose? I could also have a measure of the turbulence intensity, which I'll come to as well, which would point a turbulent Froude number. How could gamma depend on the turbulent Froude number? It's very, very difficult to determine how it depends and to understand how it might behave. And there is also this connection with other things that are obsessing me. Part of the problem is even that different people define parameters in different ways, because inevitably you involve averaging of various things and so on. And if you're in a more complicated flow, how do you actually capture those sort of parameters? So that's a critical issue that I want to talk about. So what are the sort of properties that might matter in a flow? Well, you can think about at least four different classes of properties of a stratified turbulent fluid. You have the properties of the fluid itself, because you have its dependence on nu, the viscosity of the fluid. But as soon as I allow a stratifying agent, I can have the diffusivity of the stratifying agent. So therefore, I have the ratio of that could be a Prandtl number. But in the ocean, for example, it depends on the density depends on temperature and on salt. So I can have two different diffusivities. So I can have a whole new dynamics associated with that. The real equation of state of seawater, we know the maximum density for pure water in terms of temperature happens at 4 degrees. But of course, if you add salt, you change the pressure. The point at which the density maximum occurs moves around. The standard model for equation of state of water is extremely complicated, has tens of parameters involved in it. And those phenomena can actually matter. You actually can have situations where you have a fluid parcel here which is less dense than the fluid parcel below it. But if I change the pressure, if I move them down in the ocean column, because a wave goes by, it'll move them up and down. Then as I move it down, then the parcel on top becomes more dense than the one underneath, and they have to turn over. It's called cabling. And it happens up in the polar regions. Very, very complicated. But I'm just saying we're doomed. So that's a problem to try and understand. There's also the properties of the background. There's going to be some base flow that we might have. It will have a background density gradient. There will be a characteristic shear, for example. But then you need to worry about what is meant by the overline, what is whether this varies in time and space, how I do my averaging. There's also the properties of the turbulence itself. How much kinetic energy, turbulent kinetic energy there is, what the present dissipation rate, those also could imagine setting up perturbations. But if you can then think about mathematically that really what you have in turbulence is that you are describing the properties of the velocity fluctuation field. But if I have a scalar, I can also suppose I have a density fluctuation field. I can have the intensity of the fluctuations away from this base state, this sort of RMS of the density, this analogy, which in certain circumstances can be related to the potential energy in the flow. I also have a dissipation rate of density variance, this chi quantity. That is also an important parameter. This is like a statement about how vigorous the variability in the density field is. And there's how vigorous the variability in the velocity field is, as well as the background, as well as the properties of the fluid. All of these different quantities may well be important, and so it's very, very difficult to describe what is the proper way to describe a flow. And in particular, and this is more for the students than the gray hair or no hairs, the problem is that it is absolutely unclear whether there is anything generic or universal about stratified turbulence. People suppose, people make statements that they are, it's obvious in one level, you introduce an anisotropy. And because you have a preferential direction that is given to you by your gravitational field, and you have base states that inevitably are varied, because if you have turbulence in a constant density gradient, that turbulence will tend to mix up that density gradient, so you get patches of well-mixed fluid, which inevitably, irrevocably change your base state. So there's a whole load of interesting and open questions. Does this gamma quantity vary with parameters or with mechanism? Are there different mechanisms? There's a very influential paper as well by Paul Linden from 40 years ago, which shows this particular figure. The x-axis is the a bulk measure of the stratification, and the y-axis is related to this gamma quantity. It's the flux Richardson number, but it's related to this gamma quantity. And it seems reasonable, if you think about it, if the fluid is weakly stratified, the turbulence isn't going to be much affected by the stratification. So if you make it slightly more stratified, you'll just mix more. So you would expect the mixing to go up with weak stratification. Similarly, if the fluid is very strongly stratified, you expect that's going to suppress vertical motions. Remember, the key quantity involved is the buoyancy flux, the correlation between the density and the velocity. So if you tend to reduce vertical motions, you're going to tend to have flows that are going to, you're going to have less mixing at very strongly stratified. It's arm wavy. It's not, I'm not saying it's true, Andrea. It's just, it's an argument. And so there is this possibility that you could go up and go down. And if you look at some experimental data, suggest that you indeed, weakly stratified, the mixing goes up, strongly stratified, the mixing goes down. But there's some very important recent work, including by Dr. Maffioli, which says that it doesn't necessarily go down over here. You don't. This picture may not actually be true, and it's not even clear that you can actually access this region of this strongly stratified case, because it's got its own devil in it. You say the flow, if you are very strongly stratified, you suppress vertical motions. Well, do you? Can you actually maintain turbulent flow in that region? It's not clear, particularly in real situations where you have a forcing that is not being injected by a numerical body force within your simulation. There are people who do that, including me, and you say you have the Navier-Stokes equations, and then you have a body force to keep your turbulence going. But if you try, but that's not what happens, right? There's got to be some forcing mechanism, like a wall forcing or a breaking wave or something, a physical process rather than an extra term in a numerical simulation. And are the physical processes that allow that to happen? There's also, and I'll talk about it in a minute, there's a very nice asymptotic theory, which I like calling layered anisotropic turbulence, and layered, there should be a stratified there, last, layered anisotropic stratified turbulence. And that is a regime where you're in, that you are at a very high buoyancy Reynolds number while simultaneously being extremely strongly stratified. And so then you end up with this inherent anisotropy. You can still have turbulent motions in the horizontal, and I'll try and show you schematically how that could go, but you have very much weaker vertical motions. It's not actually, I think, established whether that can happen, but as I've got it in its name, it implies that the generic way a stratified flow may evolve is into a layered structure. And what I mean by a layered structure is you have relatively deep well-mixed regions, and they're separated by thin, sharp interfaces where the gradient is much larger. Is that possible? And this connects with this point as well. Is stratified turbulence ever generic? Because I'm not entirely convinced it does. I think there is a possibility. A lot of the evidence at the moment is that the time history of the evolution of a flow is very, very important for its individual dynamics. There's also, and this is related to emerging ideas about criticality, linear stability arguments appear to be relevant to turbulent flows. There's some hints of that, which I will hopefully talk about in the next half hour. And then there's some observational data. Can that ever be connected to more complicated models? So in the last 30 minutes or so of what I'm talking about, I'm going to try and address those. But these are also can be related to Brexit, which is a nice point of break. Because, rather like the political system in Britain, the system does appear to be unstable only if the background is sufficiently weak. Once it starts, you have no way of knowing how long stratified turbulence is going to last, and you don't know. I'm not entirely sure what's going to happen when I fly back to the UK on Friday, but maybe I'll find out. And finally, the key point, which is that stratified turbulence is fundamentally unlike homogeneous isotropic turbulence, because the base state that you have is always changing qualitatively and irreversibly. Mixing, when you have density mixing, you inevitably change your base state. You change the fundamental properties of the fluid that you're looking at, and so it really changes your dynamics. So, let's talk about some of these ideas. Now, very, very important sequence of papers came out of Stanford, which suggested, here's a plot effectively of this gamma quantity against the buoyancy Reynolds number, that suggested there was a region where this gamma, where they were linearly related. But then when you got to a strong value of this, large value of this buoyancy Reynolds number, that you saw a decrease in your gamma. Now that didn't mean that your mixing didn't stay significant, because remember, kappa was gamma multiplied by the buoyancy Reynolds number. But if you went to very large values of the buoyancy Reynolds number, that you started to see a reduction in the flux coefficient, the efficiency at which you were mixing. Remember, that's the quantity here. It's really the rate. It's the taxation rate between the buoyancy flux, your conversion into potential energy, compared to your dissipation rate. Now, this numerics is numerics, and there's also some observational data plotted by people from Stanford, which also shows this decrease of this mixing with the buoyancy Reynolds number. But there is a concern inevitably in that, which is to do with whether this quantity is being independently, is an appropriate quantity to look at, because large values of this could be associated with strong turbulence, epsilon being big, or it could be associated with the stratification being rubbish, being weak, n squared being very small. So it's not at all clear whether this picture of reducing mixing when you go to high buoyancy Reynolds number is just reducing mixing when you're going to strong to weak stratification. Now, there's another way of thinking about this, which is if you think about the turbulent Prandtl number. So remember, this is the eddy diffusivity for the density, and I could similarly write down an eddy diffusivity for the momentum. And if I multiply that quantity above and below by du dz, I'll get the turbulent production if I'm in a shear flow on the top, and the square of the shear on the bottom. And so if I look at the ratio of these two parameters, I will have on one, the new t will mean I have the p on the top, and the kappa t will mean I'll have the b on the bottom. And so I will have something that is 1 over what's called the flux-Richardson number, which is another way of writing down this taxation, the buoyancy flux compared to the turbulent production rate. And if I'm in steady state, turbulent production is equal to the buoyancy flux plus the dissipation rate. So therefore, the flux-Richardson number is directly relatable to this gamma quantity. But the terms that I have left over, because of course the turbulent Prandtl number must be a non-dimensional quantity, I have left over, I have an n squared from the kappa t, but kappa t is on the bottom, so there's an n squared on the top, which remember is a square of a time scale, and I have a du dz squared on the bottom, which remember is a square of a time scale, it's the shear squared. And so that quantity is called the Richardson number. It's a balance. It's seeing how important density variations are, buoyancy is, compared to inertia, or it could be thought of in how important potential energy is to kinetic energy. It can still be related in that way. So if I'm strongly sheared, the Richardson number is small, and so therefore I am. So therefore, the turbulence may not be affected much by the stratification. Whereas if the Richardson number is large, then the stratification is strong compared to the shear, and so it's very difficult for the shear to be able to turn over and lift dense parcels up in the sort of Kelvin-Helmholtz type dynamic. So this actually comes, so then this is another way to think about this, and there's no answers in my talk, just questions. The turbulent Prandtl number is then the ratio between this Richardson number and this flux Richardson number, which is a statement about, and remember what I was talking about, the different concepts. These are properties of the background, and this is properties of the turbulence. But they're called the same, and that's no coincidence, because if you think about a classical argument of, if you suppose that the turbulent process, the scales of the eddies and so on, the structure in the velocity field is the same as the structure in the scalar field, we expect the turbulent Prandtl number to be 1, or order 1. And so therefore, we expect these to be about the same. Now, that has an interesting numerological attraction, because remember I said gamma could be about, it was modeled by Osborne to be bounded above by 0.2. There's a theorem for inviscid steady flow called the Miles-Howard theorem that says a necessary condition for instability is that the Richardson number is less than 1/4 somewhere within the flow. Why is that attractive? Well, turbulent Prandtl numbers being of order 1 then suggests that the most that the Richardson number for you to sustain turbulence could be is going to be about the same as the flux Richardson number, which is around about 0.2, which is indeed what's observed. But this then says we can't have the right flank. We can't have strongly stratified flows that are actually turbulent, that sustain turbulence, if the linear theory tells us anything relevant to the turbulent flow. And why should it? But we'll see, maybe it does. Okay. Yes? No. It's ever so slightly out of pattern. I'm going to come to that now. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So that comes down to the definition of what is meant by stratified turbulence. Because if you don't have any shear, where have you got the turbulence from? What is it, because, you know, once again, I'm coming from a world where I'm used to wall-bounded flows and instability theory. Shear injects vorticity into the system, injects a large-scale process, gives us a mechanism to get turbulence. Now, the other mechanism, maybe you would say, well, another way to get turbulence might be some convective process. But then I end up in a kind of Talmudic argument, particularly in the stratified flow. The background flow is initially statically stable. I have wave fields. If the waves steepen, they will inevitably go through a stage where they're still statically stable, but they will have induced a shear. So finite shear and yet static stability is a way that you could always suppose that you'd be able to generate turbulence. And so if you have a boundary, you will inevitably have shear. If either the assumption that you don't have shear, I would argue, is structurally unstable compared to the assumption that you do have shear. Why should the flow, on average, be going at exactly the same speed absolutely everywhere? Generically, shear is present. But in standard turbulence, they're not describing the ocean. No, because that's it. We standard turbulence, stratified homogeneous isotropic turbulence. Just write down the initials. You have a flow that is isolated from reality. Somehow or other, you've got this patch of stuff that doesn't know. But as soon as you have a boundary in the system, you are going to have a shear. That's 101. And also, there's no reason why all fluid is going at the same mean speed. Indeed, generically, it will not be. Now, you're right, I have it magically introduced shear, but if I come to the next slide, there is an argument why you would expect to always get shear. So this is the very idiot's guide to the last regime. So one of the attractions, this the picture that was put up by Laurent earlier of the, you know, you want to find this inertial range. We have a further way of interpreting this large buoyancy Reynolds number, because you can think of the buoyancy Reynolds number as a ratio of length scales. And there's no shear in what I'm writing here, but it comes about inevitably. Because you have this large, so you can think of that this is the one over the Kolmogorov scale, the micro scale. But this is another another length scale. If you think about that's L2 T minus 3. This is T minus 3, so this is L2. So I take the L squared, so I take the square root. It gives me a length. It's called the Osmodoff length scale. And it can be, you can think about, if you have a patch of fluid that's in a stratified environment and you have a turbulent eddy. Now, the turbulent eddy is going to have a certain amount of kinetic energy in it. And if it is in a stratified environment, there's a potential energy cost for that eddy to turn over. Now, if the stratification is relatively weak, the potential energy required to turn over is much less than the kinetic energy that's in the eddy, so it's not going to care about the stratification. But as you make the eddy bigger, it's costing more and more for it to overturn. The Osmodoff scale can be thought of as the scale at which it has the turbulent eddy has just enough kinetic energy to turn into potential energy when it tries to turn over. You can also describe it as it's the largest vertical length scale that is not much affected by stratification. So why is this of interest? Well, to have any chance to have the isotropic turbulence, the homogeneous, the Kolmogorovian type turbulence, you need to have a very wide range of scale separation between your injection scale and your dissipation scale. You have to be able to have a length scale in the inertial range that is very much smaller than the injection scale and still very much larger than the dissipation scale. But you've got an upper bound on this because the Osmodoff scale is the scale at which you start to be affected you start to know that the vertical is different from the horizontal. So to have any chance of an inertial range, your buoyancy Reynolds number needs to be enormous. Because you have to have room in between to have an inertial range. So if you're in a situation where you're very, very strongly, you could imagine you're strongly stratified, which is the regime that the oceans are in, you then end up with this hierarchy of scales that you can possibly imagine. You end up with these anisotropic sort of pancake-like structures that are very, very much longer than they are high. Okay? And so their Reynolds number, defined in this horizontal scale, is enormous. But they're strongly stratified because in the sense that they're very slowly moving in the horizontal. So this Froude number, this ratio between the scale at which it's moving around like this and the stratification is very strong, so this quantity is very small. So they're very, very anisotropic. But if you go through the scaling that you'd expect for the dissipation rate, you plugging in the classic inertial scaling for the dissipation rate, you require U cubed over LH to be the scaling for the dissipation, then the requirement that the buoyancy Reynolds number is very large is effectively that this Reynolds number multiplied by the square of this Froude number is still large. And that then defines for you a hierarchy of length scales. It says that the horizontal scale is enormous, the vertical length scale is much smaller than that, but is still very much bigger. I've done that. These equalities are precisely backwards. Think of these as wave numbers. L is obviously a wave number. So the horizontal scale is enormous compared to the vertical scale, compared to the Osmodoff scale, which is still enormous compared to the Kolmogorov scale. And what that implies is that you have this enormous pancake that is running past another enormous pancake. And because they're running past another enormous pancake, there's inevitably regions between them where where there is very large vertical shear, such that there is a stratified, there is a low enough Richardson number that you expect to have shear instabilities. And that's essentially the hierarchy of what's going to go on. you have these sort of pancakes, but they're like big spaceships that are swimming around in the ocean. And when they come past each other, they have they rub against each other, they have a battle, and then they go on. And they inevitably inject regions locally of low Richardson number that still, on that local scale, has a very high Reynolds number that introduces intermittent turbulence. Now, there are pictures that indeed the very important paper of Brett et al. Shows this sort of picture. You get this layered structure, and you get within these passing by layers, you get these sort of overturnings. This implies, actually, that for the length scales, since you have, I suppose it's shown here, since you have Kolmogorov type spectrum that you expect below the Osmodov scales, go like k to the minus 5/3, for the horizontal turbulence, even for scales above the Osmodov scale, when it gets very anisotropic, you still expect the horizontal spectrum to still go like k to the minus 5/3. And there is some evidence from seismic oceanography, you can find that you actually can observe this type of behavior. That hasn't resolved very well, but this is a seismic survey. This is k squared by it's what's called the slope spectrum. So it's k squared by the energy spectrum. It's the spectrum in the vorticity field. And so when it's k to the minus 3, you get a negative. K squared by k to the minus 3 gives you a negative slope. K squared by k to the minus 5/3 gives you a positive slope. And you do indeed detect this in the ocean signal. We're able to see this. And what this does, inevitably, is if you have turbulent flows that are very, very large scale and have this horizontal, this scale separation, you inevitably get regions where the Richardson number drops less than a quarter. And because inevitably you get regions where the Richardson number drops less than a quarter, you get that classical sort of stratified shear flow overturnings. Okay, now this has implications for the correct way to parameterize mixing, and I don't really have time to talk about that here, but it suggests that the way that rather than supposing that gamma is constant, which is this gamma is 0.2 along here, it suggests that the numerical evidence and also the observational evidence, the numerical evidence is the data here, observational evidence, which doesn't hasn't come out on the resolution, is the shaded things here, shows that for low buoyancy Reynolds number, you have low values of this gamma, but it goes to larger values than 0.2 and drops down. And that then modifies greatly how you might transport heat in the ocean, but I would stress this is still highly controversial, that it indeed this sort of dynamics happens. Okay, but if you suppose you have such overturning, you inevitably induce shear in your flow, you find these sort of Kelvin-Helmholtz type overturnings, the Richardson number drops to less than a quarter somewhere within the flow, and they such overturnings inevitably give you very, very high values of your buoyancy Reynolds number. This is from the simulations that we did. We found that the buoyancy Reynolds number, when calculated in these flows, can go to values of the in hundreds, but asymptotic, varies rapidly. It's a very transient process associated with these bursts of instability associated with these passing by spaceship sort of idea that you have these shear instabilities. Now, this is all very well, but this comes to my point. We have perfect knowledge in a numerical simulation. Is this, how can we ever relate this to oceanography? Well, there was a very nice suggestion that, because the thing to understand about the oceanographic situation is that it's easy to measure density. Conductivity, temperature, and depth, you can take a profile, so you can measure a density profile easily. You, of course, cannot measure your dissipation rate easily. So a real question is, how can I manage to, can I use the measurements of the density field to give me information about this, about the properties of the turbulence? And one very nice suggestion was to suppose, okay, when I take a density measure profile, I may see regions where the density field is non-monotonic. There's dense patches over light patches, which suggests I have some turbulent overturning going on. And so I could take my data and rearrange it so that I end up with a move that data measurement downwards, sort it, so that I end up with a sorted profile that is statically stable. And when I sort it, I will know how far I've had to move each of those individual parcels to sort it, and that will tell me, give me some measure of how strongly, how vigorous the turbulence was. It's called the Thorpe scale. It's the RMS of the displacements I'd have to do. Now, if I could relate the Thorpe scale to the Osmodoff scale, I would be able to resolve my kappa t. Because remember, the diffusivity is gamma by epsilon divided by n squared. And if I remember, epsilon over n cubed is the Osmodoff scale squared. So I have gamma L naught squared n. And so if I just blithely say I have a ratio of L naught to LT, and I caught with this Thorpe scale, I can write that down. I have LT squared. So if I know what this ratio is, I can measure in my density profile LT. I can measure the buoyancy frequency. I know what gamma is. It's 0.2. And so then I have a chance to be able to work out what this diffusivity is if I know what this ratio is. So the question, another question that's been of interest is, can, using numerical simulations, can we actually work out what this ratio is? So, of course you can. You run a simulation. At every instance, you know what your diffusivity is. At every instance, you can sort your density field so you work out what your Thorpe scale is. And so in this this is a picture of the simulation, and the different symbols correspond to the different times along here. So the circle there corresponds to that instant. We have a very large Thorpe scale, but there's not much turbulence, so the Osmodoff scale is really quite small. But then when we come to around the diamond, it's very turbulent, and also we have a much reduced amount that we'd have to rearrange things because it's all pretty green in the middle, and so therefore the Thorpe scale has dropped, and the Osmodoff scale is still has got large. So as the flow goes along, what effectively happens is that the Thorpe scale goes like a match. It flares, whereas the Osmodoff scale burns very slowly. It has a very slow decay because the turbulence decays off. That then means that the model presented by Dylan, which was that there was a given ratio between these two scales, 0.8, is useless, because that's effectively a stopped clock argument. There is an instant at which the ratio of the two scales for different simulations is the same. This is effectively time. But it's only an instant, and it's not generic at all. It just is that this ratio increases monotonically with time, and so you can't really use it as an appropriate proxy. And you also find that in such flows that the mixing is also not a constant. It's very rapidly varying. So if you have these overturning type instabilities, the mixing ratio, remember the model says that it should be 0.2, is really very far off, and it doesn't work at all. Okay, so for some reason it doesn't work at all, and I don't have time to talk about Goldilocks. It's a fairy story. Right, so, but is that generic? Is the overturning the only kind of mixing you can have? Well, unfortunately it isn't, because actually stratified turbulence, can act like this diffusivity. Remember, we're always arguing, the standard argument is that you say that kappa t is some parameter, and so that then is saying that you have a stratified turbulence, and it will act as a diffusivity that will tend to smear out the stratification to give you a region of weak overturning, and so then you will tend to turbulently diffuse your scalar. But that isn't always the case. Indeed, you actually can find situations where if the density stratification is very strong, the turbulence can't overturn the stratification. It can only scour it. It doesn't manage to overturn it fully. You have little parcels of the turbulence hits the interface and keeps it sharp by just scraping little bits away. That's what the scouring means. And this phenomenon actually can happen, particularly happens when the Prandtl number is of decent size. But the Prandtl number in the ocean is of order 10. In the atmosphere, of course, of gases, it's order 1. The Prandtl numbers of order 10, you get this dynamic. you find a flow rather than it overturning like this picture and you end up with a full mixing, you end up with this other kind of instability called the Holmboe instability, where you have cussed waves going along the interface and the interface survives. And so the question is the overturning type based mixing generic, or do you end up with these sort of interfacial mixing events? And indeed, it seems that you might. And what's interesting is, okay, we suppose we have such a flow. We suppose we have a Holmboe instability. And we look at we horizontally average the density everywhere. And we horizontally average the shear everywhere. And so we can then end up with a notional background stratification throughout the flow. So that's a turbulent flow. And if you look, we work out this notional background stratification throughout as time evolves. We see that in this picture here, you see it's all kind of this light green. So if we work out the probability density function associated with such a flow and work out what at every point the Richardson number is, and we plot it, we find that the PDF is extremely highly peaked. It's extremely highly peaked precisely at a quarter. I.e., this is appears to be evolving into a self-organized criticality so that everywhere within the flow, it's marginally stable to a linear instability. And if the shear slightly increases, it goes unstable, just like the sand pile analogy. You mix a bit, you slow down a bit, your Richardson number comes back to a quarter. And in this kind of flow, if you work out your gamma, rather, remember I said for the Kelvin-Helmholtz, it goes to very, very large values. But for these sorts of self-organized criticality, the gamma equals 0.2 appears to happen. That's gamma is 0.2. This is for 8 different simulations with loads of different initial stratifications. All that they had in common was that they were unstable to this scouring instability rather than the overturning instability. And they all sit on 0.2. So Osborne's model that you have this steady value of tax appears to be associated with long-lived instability mixing where you don't have strong overturnings, you have this scouring process that organizes into self-organized criticality. What happens if you but this was a freely evolving flow. What happens if you introduce boundaries? There are observations also from the equatorial undercurrent. These are observations of the Richardson number, the PDF of it, and you'll see it is also strongly peaked at a quarter. So this suggests that the flow is evolving into a state where you have a turbulent Prandtl number of order 1, and in the ocean we see it, and for this scouring sort of Holmboe instability rather than the overturning, we also saw it. What happens if you introduce real forcing? So this is the problem we looked at was stratified plane Couette flow. So we have walls moving at constant speed and held at constant density. We drive them faster and faster and faster and increase the stratification. And we found the following amazing phenomenon. As you increase the Reynolds number, you can increase the Richardson number, but not ad nauseam. The black ones are the flows that go that laminarize, and the other flows are ones that are turbulent, and the color is the fraction of the flow that is turbulent. And this is actually matching with the Monin-Obukhov similarity theory, because you end up with a situation where if you have a wall here that's kept at one density and a wall there that's kept at another density, that then tells you that on average you have a constant flux. It emerges as a solution of the problem, but you have a constant flux. Vertical heat flux is constant throughout the system. What it is depends on the local gradients near the boundaries, but you have this constant flux through the system if it's in steady state. That then means you can write down a similarity solution for the velocity and the density field. And that similarity solution is the dashed lines, and the numerical simulation is the curved lines. It's very, very good approximation. What that then means is, as I make the flow more and more strongly stratified, whatever the value of the Richardson number, in the boundary layers near the walls, I'm going to get a stronger stratification at low Reynolds number. And so I eventually can't get momentum away from the walls. The flow laminarizes. So I can't have strongly stratified wall force turbulence. If I look at how the Richardson number varies, the flux Richardson number varies with the Richardson number, remember this is related to the gamma, they vary linearly. That's essentially saying the turbulent Prandtl number is the same, and then you fall off a log. You can't get larger than this value, about 0.2. So you are inevitably stuck. Stratified turbulence, when it's forced at the wall, can only get to a stratification which is about this sort of marginally stable case. And so you might think, well, isn't this all about the fact, which is, it's like I set Jacques up with the question, that the problem is I'm always trying to say my turbulence is being caused by vertical shear. That's my injection mechanism. Shear introducing spanwise vorticity, and this horizontal vorticity inevitably has a cost of overturning in the vertical. I'm working against the potential energy. Wouldn't it be much better if I was forcing horizontally? Because then I can inject a lot more energy. Well, something else happens there. If we do, the easiest way to do it is if we do, which is motivated actually by a PhD that I was invited to do, its work of Yambert Flores that motivated me to do this. Start off with Taylor-Couet, which is the classic way to introduce horizontal shear, and stratify it in the vertical direction. And if you do this, you can get a beautiful evolution of the flow. You're injecting a load of kinetic energy into the system. You get this constant angular momentum across the width of the channel. It all works perfectly. This is the angular momentum, perfectly constant. There's nothing stopping you moving horizontally. But what happens is that the stratification, if you start off with the linear stratification, you spontaneously form layers. So that you spontaneously layer. You never remain with a strong stratification in the sense that you have regions of weak stratification where there's lots of turbulence and sharp interfaces between them, which is very reminiscent. What we have here, of course, is there's horizontal shear, so there's vertical vorticity. That's very reminiscent of the Billont and Chaumaz case. They had vertical vortices in a linearly stratified flow, and what happens? They spontaneously zigzag and they form layers. So if you have horizontal shear, you seem to inevitably introduce layering. Here's a video of the experiment. This, you will see a shadow graph develop. No, that's the one I want to go. And you'll see that inevitably you get layers. Inevitably layers develop in this case. And this is like a Bayeux tapestry of the same situation. I take a line here and I plot it at the beginning. It's uniform. It goes later. Later on, I see these spiral structures coming from the top and bottom. And then I get layers form that appear and disappear, appear and disappear, appear and disappear. So the layer is present. That's an interface that I see there. It disappears, it reappears, it disappears, reappears. Remember, this is like a line here through this particular picture. So if I have horizontal shear, I seem to inevitably get layering. And so even in this case, I can't support a truly strongly stratified flow because I always have regions that are very, very well mixed, which are separated by sharp interfaces that occasionally mix and don't mix and mix and don't mix, which is by analogy with this sort of picture I had by the ships passing each other. U over N. What does that mean? There's a characteristic velocity in the system and the original background stratification. That is like if it's inertially dominated, that sets the scale of the layers. But it's like that's the same scaling you get from the zigzag instability. It is a sort of generic statement that you're going to, it's the same scale that's set by that sort of pancake picture I had before. If you have turbulence in a stratified fluid that is well maintained, you inevitably get layers, and just like your dissipation scales like U cubed over L, then your vertical scale is going to scale like U over N, just spontaneously layers. Okay, so what happens if I try and introduce a body force? So some crazy simulations with Gavin Portwood and Steve De Bruijnkops at the University of Massachusetts. So we had uniformly sheared and stratified flow, and we required it to be statistically steady. We did a sort of a controlled system. So we increased, so we had a target amount of kinetic energy in the turbulence and a target Reynolds number by fitting the new. And then we changed the gravity until the flow remained in steady state. And so this organically told us, shows what would be the Richardson number that would maintain this turbulence. But it came as a solution from the problem, not from our own imposition. And it didn't tell us what, and it automatically also just gave us the taxation rate. The ratio between B and epsilon was not input, it was just for steady state, there had to be some balance would occur. And these were crazy big simulations, up to 10 to the 11, 100 billion grid points. Thank God I didn't have to analyze them. So anyway, what happened when we did these simulations and we got up to buoyancy Reynolds number of 1,000, this is the turbulent Prandtl number. It is 1. That's 1. This isn't a log scale. It's 1. The gamma, in this case, that's 0.2. That's the hypothesis of decreasing from the Stanford group. Didn't happen in these simulations. We got 0.2. And what happened here was that organically the flow adjusted to having a Richardson number around about 0.16. It was constantly sheared, so we had a unique measure of it. And the turbulent Froude number, epsilon over n by k, where that was the kinetic energy, epsilon and n adjusted, so the turbulent Froude number was about 0.5. Now, in the lingo of for the specialists, that means that for us to be able to maintain statistically steady turbulence at arbitrarily large, at very, very large buoyancy Reynolds number, it adjusted to being in a regime that was not strongly stratified. It adjusted into a regime that was shear dominated, and we couldn't get it to be turbulent when it was strongly stratified. If you require the flow to have a constant N background on average, it will adjust to this relatively weakly stratified flow, and the turbulent Prandtl number's 1, and the taxation rate's 0.2. This is the closest to an arbitrary patch of turbulence. It's not really the ocean, but it suggests that if I have a steadily forced flow, I can't have that steadily forced flow to be strongly stratified. And if I have turbulence in a stratified flow, the highest value the Richardson number can have is about 0.2. If I have horizontal shear, I automatically layer. And this mixing, if I am steady, the mixing parameter tends to tune to at most 0.2. And if I'm transient, it can be very much larger values. But if I am, only if I have a vigorous overturning can I have large values. If I don't have vigorous overturning, if I have this scouring dynamic, it's about 0.2 as well. So I hope after that hour and a quarter, you understand that we effectively have no idea what's going on. But there are several very, very suggestive points still. Stability theory does seem to have a relevance. Even when the flow is turbulent, it could be numerology, but this around about 0.2, a quarter, inevitably appears to emerge, and the flow can't be turbulent without internal forcing beyond Richardson number a quarter. And if it's left to its own devices, if it's required to be in steady state, it adjusts to being about 0.2. The force flows don't seem to have any connection, don't necessarily have connection with freely evolving flows. If you have a big overturning like a Kelvin-Helmholtz billow, the mixing is different, the turbulence is different at all stages through its evolution compared to the scouring dynamics. That big overturning always leaves its imprint on the properties of the turbulence afterwards. And so how you are supposed to parametrically describe in terms of non-dimensional parameters, such flows, since they are the freely evolved, the history matters so much. If you introduce horizontal shear, and indeed if you, for the long-lived mixing, they inevitably appear to be layered. You always seem to get this sharp interface well mixed, shaft interface well mixed. It's very artificial to maintain constant density. And if I have the dynamics of a wall-bounded flow is inherently different from a non-wall-bounded flow. And so I'm a bit concerned about whether deterministic physics models can actually describe this mixing adequately. Because every time I look at a different situation, the different situation seems to have fundamentally different characteristics. Okay, so I've gone on for far too long, and we all need a coffee, but I should acknowledge all the people who actually did the work. So, thank you. Stunned silence. You measure, when you measure Froude number of 10 to the minus 3, I'm not convinced that you're seeing the vigorous turbulent event. So it is about it comes right down to this point about what do you call stratified turbulence. Is what is important the sort of low-level background situation or a very vigorous event? So you say you go to the pycnocline. I would argue a lot of the mixing that happens at the pycnocline are intermittent mixing events. Yes. I would argue you do. But where does the, when I say it's intermittent mixing events, what is providing the energy for that event?
Yeah, so it's breaking internal waves.
Yeah, and the breaking internal waves are shears.
Yes, but the shear is not maintained.
No, but oh,
number one.
So that connects with my point that the forced situations are very different from the free situations. So the events when you have a breaking wave could be like the overturning Kelvin-Helmholtz type situation, and the sustained cases are when you have some relatively long-lived forcing mechanism. What matters? What are the important phenomena to happen? So you measure the Froude number is 10 to the minus 3, but when you measure the Froude number is 10 to the minus 3, you're not seeing a vigorous event.
Well, measurements have 0.0 to 100 micro-get
in the fixed
line.
Yeah.
And they have two numbers of 10 to the minus 3. So it's vigorous turbulence, but it's not very strong.
Yeah, but that's very old data, and there's also the issue in those things, those measurements, that there is a resolution on which you've done the measurement. So it also comes down to what you are actually choosing as your value, you know, what your value of epsilon is and what your value of n is, what the appropriate measurements that you're doing. This is exactly my point about talking across purposes. So the question is, does the strongly stratified turbulence actually be sustained in the ocean, for example, or are you observing the long tail of something that was more vigorous earlier that is doing something much more significant? Yeah.
Yeah.
yeah, but it depends on the picture of what you think of what is mattering in the strongly stratified turbulence regime, because the strongly stratified turbulence regime is that the Froude number is very small, the buoyancy Reynolds number is still large, and you have these large values. That inevitably means you have regions where the Richardson number drops to low value, and you do have shear. Oh no, but okay. There were multiple frame situations I talked about. It's definitely not the same as the stratified Couette problem, but the only way you're going to have a mixing is when it's going to be the shear related instabilities. Because when I was showing that this particular picture here, the key concept to draw from this picture is that this scale is enormous. This scale is tiny compared to that scale, but locally here, the Reynolds number is still large. And so what I'm arguing is what's happening here is like one of the Kelvin-Helmholtz billows.